Council Member Donovan Richards, thank you so much for being with us on ITV Gold. I know you're joining us from District 31st. Thank you for, you know, giving us an insight into New York City, insight into what's happening here. But my first question to you has to be, how are you doing and how is the team of yours doing right now?
Well, it has been one of the most complicated times, I think, in our career. And I come from a community, so I represent the Rockaways as well. And for many of you who remember the Rockaways, we were really devastated by Hurricane Sandy. So we had a little experience on how to jumpstart and really hit the ground running, partially because of that particular event. But this one is sort of a lot more challenging because we all are supposed to practice social distancing. So it's just about trying to make sure I don't put my staff at risk, although many of them have gone out, including today, to volunteer to give food out to seniors and that sort of stuff. So we've been doing a lot of that because food insecurity is huge around Queens and around our community. But everybody's holding up well. But well, by God's grace, all of us are healthy. One of my staff members did lose her uncle this week. We've lost a lot of people from our community, a lot of community leaders. So that's been really challenging and tough. But it's really about, really been about ensuring that we're delivering for our hospitals and keeping government accountable during this time to our communities.
Councilmember, you have particularly been very, on the front line in terms of delivering meals and in terms of getting food donated throughout the districts. Could you reflect on the importance of those programs for you and your team? And also, where has this food gone so far? And what is the current need for food in the district?
So, listen, it's been great working with the administration. Yesterday, I had a great conversation with the mayor's food czar, Catherine Garcia. She's in charge of all food access for the city now, someone who I really entrust to really run this program well. She was just put in charge of that. But it's really been about ensuring that, one, there's public access to food. So for many of our public schools, we wanted to make sure it just wasn't the standard meal. We needed halal meals. We needed kosher meals. We wanted to make sure every type of food was available for different communities, the variation of that, because no one should go hungry during this pandemic. With nearly a $90 billion budget being proposed. The city council just reached an agreement. We just reached an agreement with the mayor on an additional $25 million that's gonna go to food pantries across the city. And why is that important? Because our community-based organizations know our communities better than anyone. There's no government agency that could come in and understand our communities the way we do. So that $25 million we're working to ensure reaches every pocket of Queens so that no one goes hungry. And then once again, just ensuring that the variation of public schools are open and that the meals are reaching the communities and certainly are sensitive to our diverse culture right here in Queens, right? We're very diverse. So we wanna make sure the meals match the culture and diversity of our borough. So those are some of the things we've been up to. We're also working with a lot of volunteer organizations, and I want to thank them for the work that they've been doing from Western Queens to Southern Queens. There's been a lot of work done to ensure that those organizations are getting boots on the ground and the support they need to get food into everybody's hands.
Councilmember, has it been difficult ensuring that no one goes hungry in the district?
Oh, I mean, of course, there's always a struggle because, you know, as someone who represents 160,000 people, how do you communicate to 160,000 people? So we've worked very hard to do door-to-door deliveries. Last week, I packed up my own Jeep. We dropped off about 200 boxes of food to public housing residents. And that was great. Today, once again, we are working with SNAP, which is a big senior organization. So we got some donations of food in. We were able to make sure that seniors who were not included in the city's DFTA plan, Department for the Aging plan, were able to get food for the weekend. And then what we're going to be doing for anybody watching is if You call 311 and you request a meal, which they will give you, and it's free. I mean, they deliver 6 meals. If you've requested and don't get that food, we're going to be following up with the city to ensure that you're getting your continuous meal. So you should know you can call our office at 718-527-4356 and leave your information if you've signed up with the city and have not gotten communicated with.
And are you also looking for community members that might be watching you on ITV Gold right now to perhaps help volunteer?
Oh, absolutely.
Are there opportunities for that?
Absolutely. Just this afternoon, too, we were out. My staff was out as well. So we're getting pallets of food in, and we're actually separating it ourselves. So one of the things we want people to know is that we are doing this in a safe manner, that social distancing is being practiced. And we're also working with the city to make sure that PPE is being provided to volunteers as well. So if you need protection, if you don't have masks, you don't have gloves, we'll be able to supply that sort of equipment for you so that you can feel safe. But there are a lot of organizations we're plugging into, and absolutely, we're looking for volunteers. So if you want to volunteer, please call that number once again, 718-527-4356, and we'll certainly add you to our list.
And you just highlighted on PPE. This brings me to the entire situation of the healthcare crisis that we're in right now, and also, you know, the plight, perhaps you can call it, of the hospitals of New York City.
Yeah.
You know, we had the Elmhurst Council member also discuss the issues in the hospitals even right now. I'd like to know, has the conditions improved in your district, and also what are your greatest needs of the hour in terms of healthcare especially?
So there's always been challenges around healthcare in Queens, and in light of a lot of the closures that also happened. You think about Mary Immaculate Hospital that closed right down in Jamaica many years ago. That has now become Luxury Towers. You think of the closure of Peninsula Hospital in about 2007 or 8 in the Rockaways. So we have one hospital serving nearly 200,000 people. So we've always had those challenges. And I think this crisis now gives us an opportunity as the federal government starts to send money into the states to supply hospitals with more support, making sure that that money is reaching pockets of our communities like Elmhurst Hospital, Jamaica, Queens Hospital. So that's going to be very important. I do want to say today I did a call with my hospitals. My hospital in particular, St. John's Hospital, and conditions are starting to improve. We worked very hard to make sure they were getting the PPE that they needed, rightfully needed, and they've gotten that. There still are a lot of workers out sick, but because of the new supply of volunteers and out-of-state people coming in, they've been able to sort of fill that gap. Another thing we can't forget about is clinics, and clinics are also filling the void. So we have the Adabo Health Center that has been doing some great work. They actually are just about to become a testing site, but they've been piloting and doing testing for many of our community members. They've been doing good, but they've been short on gowns, right? I mean, gowns, there's been a big shortage in that. So they're currently, even as they test people, they're using garbage bags as gowns. So we're trying to work to make sure that every level of government works with them to fix that issue. So there's been some slight improvements, but the thing is, it's hard to measure improvement when you got 500 or 400 people dying a day in New York City around this.
Definitely. And in terms of testing and all the developments, currently, what is your personal take on the roles of state and federal governments, especially when we're looking at the biggest question of the hour, reopening? It has really scared, the medical professionals of the community, especially because, as you just said, we're talking about still lack of PPEs. We're talking Yep. about still hospitals at overcapacity. We're talking about still testing not being, we don't have a full form of optimized testing.
Yep. Yep.
What is your take on what are we going to do about this reopening situation?
Well, you can't reopen without mass testing. That's the bottom line. Otherwise, we'll be going into the summer, we'll be going into the fall, we'll be going into the winter, and this epidemic will still be living with us. So I've been one of the leading voices on the city council, in particular, pushing the mayor even to make sure that there are more testing sites in our communities. Now, communities of color, immigrant communities have been the ones hit the hardest during this pandemic. And it's a shame that it's taken so long for testing to reach our pockets of our community, because by us not getting tested, that was a death sentence for a lot of our elders, for a lot of members of our community. So that's now starting to ramp up. Even today in the district, I have antibody testing going on at supermarkets. We're starting to see more sites come online. But absolutely, when you look at the countries and places that have really been able to navigate this crisis, they tested and tracked. Those were the two solutions to actually reopening their economies and minimizing the cases. So testing has to absolutely happen in communities of color, in immigrant communities, and anything less will never get us an economy that works for everybody in Queens.
So in terms of addressing, you know, the brown communities and the black communities, we are talking about racial disparity right now. Yep. There is, you know, so much we're hearing in the news about the needs of their communities, what is happening around, you know, in the hospitals there. Could you please address, you know, the South Asian American community, the Indo-American community, all brown and black communities here on ITB Gold, but also address us on what should we do about what's happening here right now?
So the first thing is to make sure that the city and the state are concentrating resources in our pockets. And I was very happy because I actually wrote a very scathing editorial a few weeks ago about the lack of testing and data. Data is very important when you're talking about getting resources into pockets of the South Asian community, into Black and Brown communities, period. So that data was central in us being able to tell our stories. So once that data came out, it showed how impacted South Asian communities were, African American communities were, our Hispanic communities were being impacted. So that was the impetus in now us starting to get some movement on testing sites in our communities. What should be happening right now is that the city should be concentrating services into the pockets of our communities. Now, everybody doesn't have internet access, so you may have to do snail mail. You have to work with local community-based organizations because not everybody trusts government. We're scared. I mean, my dad just became a citizen last year. I mean, we all are scared of the Trump administration, what they will do during this time. Will they use the information they get to deport us, right? So the city is now, the mayor has sort of said he's going to start pivoting towards ensuring direct text gets to people, that CBOs, community-based organizations who we trust, could get the resources to get information out, the testing being enhanced in our communities, food access, which is huge.
Yeah.
Food access, more resources being poured into the pockets that have been hit the hardest is going to be central in getting our communities moving forward. I do feel relatively good about now more PPE reaching our hospitals, but we need to make sure PPE is also getting out into our communities too. So yeah, that's going to be the next venture we're pushing for as well.
And in terms of addressing another huge group of people who are truly at the center of this crisis, are children. Yeah. You know, after we look at communities of color and all of the other things happening in the hospitals, children are all home. To a million of Americans that are sitting home right now, it has put the entire American life into a strange environment.
Yeah.
I would like for you to give us an insight into what's happening with the public schooling system, especially in New York City, and you know what resources can we look forward to, because we have a lot of parents watching you right now.
So first off, you should go to, if you're watching and you have internet access, schools.nyc.gov. And you should look on there. There's a bevy of resources, whether it's around food, whether it's around internet and access to laptop carts, if your children actually go to a public school. And one of the things I've been pushing on is ensuring that every child in our New York City school system has access to a laptop and to the internet. I mean, there's no reason that our kids should fall behind during this crisis because the Department of Education isn't getting the information out. So I think as of last night, they shipped out about 215,000 devices. Wow. But we know that there are a million school students in our public school system. So language access is critical. You know, you have to have materials that speak the language, Bengali and, you know, whatever language you speak the language of the community. So we're pushing hard to make sure that those resources and people know that they can get those devices and access to internet immediately. The food stuff seems to be moving good. I know even for Ramadan, yesterday there was a great announcement on more food being poured into communities so that no one goes hungry even during this time, because we're all together, well, all trying to be together. It's a little different this year, but ensuring that those resources are being poured in. And then also the services are going to be very important. One of the things I'm most worried about is for our kids with disabilities, and how is the Department of Education ensuring that those children who need access to resources won't be left behind. I want to be honest, it's possible, and I think I've been reading between the lines a little bit, that you can see us going into fall and a lot of our kids still being home partially because of the COVID pandemic. I know, I was like losing the word. So mental health is what I'm most worried about. Yes. You know, I have a 4-year-old, by the way. I do remote learning with him. Wow. Very tough. You know, so it's very important for the parents watching. And I just did a virtual town hall on mental health this week.
Right.
Very important for parents to ask their kids about their feelings. So I asked my son, you know, are you sad? You know, when he started acting out a little bit. And, you know, he said he's sad. He misses his classmates.
Yeah.
So we have to actually communicate. I would also add, sorry, I'm taking long on this.
Of course.
We need to make sure that there's a regular routine for them.
Yeah.
So very important. And that's something the specialist talked about. So putting your children on a schedule is very important. I'm lucky because my wife's an educator, so I'm able to follow her lead on this stuff. But make sure you're putting your children on a regular schedule.
May I ask you just quickly, just to follow up on that, what are some of her basic challenges, not even the biggest challenge, the basic challenges doing remote learning, educating somebody? What are some of the things that she has to deal with on a daily basis?
Well, what I got to deal with is a 4-year-old who does not want to sit still during remote learning. I mean, that's a big challenge, that to tell a 4-year-old to sit still for about an hour. He has 2 sessions a day. But you know, the social and emotional piece is the biggest problem. I mean, most of our children are used to sitting in a classroom with each other and conversing and communicating and going out to gym and getting, you know, physical health and that regular meal and a little bit more comfort from their teachers and their guidance counselors. So that's what's really missing when children are locked inside all day. You know, one of the things we do is today is raining, so we couldn't take, you know, my son on a walk, but it's very important for our kids to get air to. So if you can, you know, you walk them around the block and get back inside in a safe manner and keep social distancing as well. So that's what I would say is tough, that one-on-one where people can converse in a classroom where our children can be children and kick a ball outside. That's the hardest part of all of this. So I think, you know, we're going to have some challenges moving ahead with our children and their mental health. But when the schools open, I think that should be a big focus.
And do you wish to have more resources in terms of mental health awareness and help available while we get out of this pandemic as well? Because it seems like this is going to be a huge issue when we are getting out of this.
Right. So on my Facebook, you can go on, and I'm certainly will make sure we send you the information as well so you could have it. But Thrive NYC, you can call 311 and they will give you some tips. They can also connect you to counselors as well, which is very important during this period. You know, we should not all pretend like we are not all impacted by this crisis, right? As strong as we all are, we all are going through some mental health crises, being locked inside all day, some sort of levels of anxiety. Some people are dealing with deep levels of depression. So the most important thing we can do is get the help, ask for help, and it's anonymous. You know, no one will know that it's you. So call 311, connect with Thrive, and I'm telling you, it makes a difference being able to talk to someone.
You know, while I still have you on this interview, I have a couple more questions before we let you go here. Number one was, you recently called out and actually called on for more support for the EMS workers and other healthcare workers that have been around in New York City. Could you reflect on what you were referring to and what exactly is needed for those specific workers?
So the EMS, especially the EMS workers, have been sorely under-resourced. And these are the people who absolutely are, they're you call 911, they're coming to your door. I mean, they've been, like many of our healthcare workers, have been through a lot of trauma over the course of the last month or so, right? I mean, they're seeing dead bodies, but also a lot of them are getting impacted by COVID as well. And partly because the city has not giving them enough PPE. So we are working with a lot of my colleagues, Paul Vallone, the EMS union, to make sure that we can highlight those needs and try to fill the gaps that the city's not reaching currently. I know I'll be sending a shipment to the EMS union shortly. We're working with an Asian organization, actually, to try to provide 15,000 masks to the NYPD currently. And once again, just getting back to our hospitals, making sure that our healthcare workers are getting the PPE they need. And one of the things I'm working on, which we're going to be talking a lot about as we move ahead, is the need to make sure that there's mental health services for our frontline workers,
right,
and also a hotline for them to directly complain to people. Right now, a lot of our healthcare workers, what I'm finding, are being told to keep your mouth shut. Don't complain. Don't speak to the newspapers. They should have a place they can centrally go to report things that need to be improved in their institutions free of retribution. So those are some of the things we're working on. But EMS, it's horrible. I mean, folks are going through a lot of trauma. And the least we can do as a city is treat them with the respect they deserve and dignity by ensuring that they have the PPE they need.
Definitely, this whole issue of PPE is so important. You have also called on the jail prison system on, you know, again, more protection for workers there, and also on the increase of COVID cases in prisoners. I thought that was a very interesting aspect because, you know, we're always talking about the rates of incarceration and then the amount of capacity that the jails have. Could you reflect on what's happening?
So I'm happy to say, at least on Rikers Island, there's been some progress. And once again, there's a very delicate balance when you're talking about preserving public safety and the health and well-being of people, right? So we want to make sure we have safe communities and that, you know, anybody we're working with to ensure they can be freed won't pose a drastic public safety risk to our communities.
Right.
But one of the things we're stressing, you have a lot of people locked up over low-level offenses or waiting their court dates. You have senior citizens who really are not public safety risk. They've served 50 years. They have a year left on their sentence. Should they come home now? Probably yes. If you're not a deemed a public safety threat, you should be able to come home. I have a private jail. I have the only private jail in New York City in my district, which is the GEO prison in Springfield Gardens. And we've recently uncovered that prison has had a huge breakout around COVID in it, including with its workers and its inmates. So for some people watching, you may know the popular rapper Tekashi 6ix9ine. He was there. He got released. So that's right in the backyard of my district. But there's still a big wildfire that they have not been able to extinguish right now. And we've been working and calling on the U.S. Marshals to ensure that they're having a lot more oversight to protect people there. You know, if you've been convicted of something, it doesn't mean you should get a death sentence in prison over COVID-19. So progress on Rikers Island. We're working with our district attorneys. There's been some progress there. And let me just add that New York City is still safe. I mean, we've seen 40% reductions in crime, technically, over the course of the last month. So it's not like the release of these low-level offenders or people we're letting out have come out and made crime go up drastically. We've seen drastic cuts in crime even during this period.
Yes, and let's hope that we all stay safe and, you know, everyone stays healthy here. I have to ask you, I know we're coming towards the end of the interview, but the economic downfall, it is impacting all of us pretty much equally, some even more than the others.
Yep.
We have the stimulus package, but as everyone's been talking about, most of it has been used. Yep. Your take on what is needed in terms of the economic downfall in the district, and how should we all look at this situation?
Yeah. So without a doubt, you know, I was driving to get some coffee today, and I started to see rent signs up For rent signs up on a lot of small businesses along corridors on Linden Boulevard. So I'm really worried about the impact of this crisis on small businesses, which really are the livelihood of a lot of our communities as well. A lot of our small businesses are undocumented Black and Brown folks who really built the foundation in our communities and stayed even when others wanted to leave our communities. So I'm really worried about the state of, will the stimulus money actually reach the small businesses it's intended to do? So from a city council perspective, one of the things I'm tracking is even as that money comes down from the federal government to the city, is that money reaching our small businesses, our immigrant communities across Queens? So I'm looking for that data, and we'll be talking a lot more. I'm looking at legislation around this as well to require the city to report on where they're giving loans and grants at so that we can make sure there's accountability there. Also, the stimulus package, the CARES Act, the stimulus money that's coming down where individuals will be able to get a paycheck, get a check monthly, or has not reached undocumented population. I was very happy to hear the mayor propose giving a check to undocumented people. We have to see how that's going to work out. How's he going to flesh that out? How are we going to reach individuals who are undocumented? But I thought that that was a really good step in the right direction, ensuring that those who may not qualify for the CARES Act to qualify for that specific money. The economy is going to shift. I mean, without a doubt, everybody's working remotely as well. I wonder if, as we move forward, will we see more remote working happening? I think America's culture around working is going to shift totally, being that all of us have now discovered Zoom and everything else, and we could actually operate from home and actually still be effective. So I think it's important to watch the workforce there. But without a doubt, this money has to reach Main Street, not just Wall Street. And I think that's what's happening at this moment with the Trump administration.
Yeah, you know, thank you so much for your time here on ITV Gold. Not only do I want you to give one last message to our audience, but I would also like to know what your focus is now for the next couple of weeks as we go into what they are saying, more of the flattening of the curve and us getting out of the pandemic, hopefully.
Well, I want to thank ITV Gold for having me today and representing the voices of communities that could be left out of the conversation. You know, ethnic media is so important for our communities because, once again, we trust news organizations like ITV Gold to give real information that's catered to our community. So I want to thank you with that. As we start to transition and I guess get off the pause that we're on now that the governor has declared, you know, centrally what I'm going to be focused on is the economy largely right here in Queens. We want to make sure that a lot of the ethnic businesses in our communities are getting the resources that they need right away, that those resources are reaching them so that our communities are not left behind while everybody else is opening. Food security is going to be very important. So making sure, because I think, you know, millions of people have lost their jobs right here in New York State, right? And right here in New York City. So we're going to need to ensure that everybody who's lost their job currently has access to food. I also want to see rent subsidies increased across the city so people can make their rent payments. You know, their mortgage payments. We need to see a lot more assistance around that. So as the economy starts to pick up eventually, we're filling those holes and we're not leaving people in the homeless system. So so those are going to be some things that we focus on. Immigration, burial assistance, right? A lot of us have had to bury our loved ones. I agree with Councilmember Francisco Moya. There needs to be a burial fund for families so that we can bury our loved ones with dignity and respect. So those are going to be a lot of the areas we focus on. And then I chair public safety for the city council, which gives me oversight over the New York City Police Department. So we want to make sure we continue to focus on hate crimes. We want to focus on ensuring that they're keeping our communities secure and safe, but also looking at their budget. I mean, do we need to graduate a whole new police class when crime is down? Could that money be redistributed into our communities to resolve a lot of the poverty issues that are going to impact us? So those are some of the things we're going to be working on immediately. And we're laying some foundation and work for that already. I'm actually devising a plan to sort of get our district up and running right away now so that, you know, when they say no longer a pause, we can hit the ground running right away. So that's where we're at.
Well, I wish you all the very best on this. And if you could just give your wishes for Ramadan to all of the Muslims observing it all across the country, that would be really great to end our interview on that.
Thank you. And I want to wish everybody a blessed Ramadan. And I know it feels a little different this year. But one thing we could count on is keeping our faith in Allah, keeping our faith and what is all to come. I know it's difficult, it's complicated right now, but we're going to get through this, and we'll continue to get through this as a community. We should all continue to look out for our neighbors in need. If you got two apples and you could eat one, you should give the other one to your neighbor so that their belly can be full for the night as well. And we've seen a lot of that generosity around Queens. Queens is a very special place. And if it was not for the heroism of many people in our communities, this crisis would even be worse. There would be people who go to bed hungry. To our frontline workers and healthcare workers in our communities, thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you for your sacrifice, because if it were not for you, there would be this would be even a more of a tragedy for our community. So I want to thank you, and let's look out for each other. That's what the Quran teaches us. That's what the Bible teaches us. There are valuable lessons in all of these, in all of our different books. No matter who we serve and who we worship, we know that there's one God. So thank you so much. May blessings and peace be upon you. Enjoy, and may you have a great Ramadan.
Councilmember Richards, thank you again for joining us.